Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in to this week's classic episode of Angler West. This week we're in Oregon on Green Peter Reservoir for a Kokanee Power Derby back in 2010. Now we're going to catch lots of fish on lots of different lures, but in particular, this is a time when the Wiggle Hoochie Bill was first introduced by Shasta Tackle. Now the Wiggle Hoochie, or the Wiggle Hoochie Bill, is basically just a hoochie with a sort of crankbait bill on it. Now this is something that's come along since then. It's the salmon size, or the large size Wiggle Hoochie, so you can see it better. But this is a really neat product that's put out now by Max Lure. That's Wiggle Hoochie is now a Max Lure product. But you can see this big crankbait bill, and it's a two-hook mooching rig run through just your basic hoochie that really gets the salmon going. These have become very popular. Now you've got the original peewee hoochie. This size is great for trout and kokanee. But also, I've noticed early in the season, there's quite a few guys now that are rigging these up for salmon, full-size salmon out in the ocean. When the bait's really small, just trying to match the hatch, so to speak. So they'll rig these up with salmon-sized hooks and really do well with them. So that's another option. But these two Wiggle Hoochie patterns here really get on the fish good. I've had some really great luck up in like Winter Harbor and other places with these Wiggle Hoochie bills, and they're really selling well. They come in lots of different colors. Right now, we've got the orange is a new color that's just out, and then also pink, and you've got your UV, clear UV, and also just plain clear, and also chartreuse, which I'm sold out of in the bigger size, but that chartreuse has been very popular. So you have all those same colors in the peewee size as well. Now they're simple to make yourself, or you can just buy them all rigged up like this. However, it's as simple as just taking whatever hoochie you like and nipping off the very tip of it and shove that bill right up in there, and that's all it takes. You don't need to use any glue or anything. You can glue them if you want, but I don't think that's necessary. Then you just run your two-hook rig through. You can put a little chunky on here, a little piece of herring cut beveled at an angle, or anchovy, or whatever bait fish you might want to use, or a strip of bait. That works well too. And sometimes you don't need the bait. Just put the Wiggle Hoochie down there, and that action that it gives, a kind of a crankbait action back and forth, just drives the fish crazy. It works really well for all kinds of species of fish. Now, let's go to Green Peter, and we're going to catch some kokanee back in the day with Kokanee Power of Oregon.
Cut these on real dry, right?
You bet. Kokanee fishing, especially competitive kokanee fishing, has grown dramatically in the West over the past decade, primarily due to the accomplishments of fishing enhancement organizations such as Kokanee Power, whose efforts have both improved the fisheries and the skills of the anglers who pursue these landlocked sockeye salmon. This week, we're fishing the Kokanee Power of Oregon's Green Peter Reservoir Derby, where participants usually start off by pre-fishing the day before the derby begins. And every derby gives you a chance to learn from expert anglers.
You know, the one thing I like most about these Kokanee Power tournaments is, other than just being able to go out and fish all day, when you're done fishing the evenings, it's just a big party in the campgrounds. Everybody pretty much stays at the same place. So in the evening, you go around from person to person, and they'll tell you their tips and techniques on how they're fishing and how it makes them more successful. So it's kind of cool. You can learn a lot of stuff on top of catching some good fish.
Yeah, these are some of the kokanee that we caught today pre-fishing the day before the derby, and caught them up to 15 and a half inch was the biggest one, and we let a few smaller ones go, but we probably hooked about 15 fish. Real good day of fishing, nice fish, and we'll show you what we caught them on. These are some of the lures that we used today. The hoochies were really good, especially the spinner hoochies in that color was very productive. The cripplers did real good in the UV color. That's kind of a speckled, and that's a clear UV. Didn't try that one yet today. The humdingers, we caught a couple on dropper lines on the humdingers. And we caught some on apexes. We didn't try any kokanee bugs, but tried a variety of things, and we caught like a couple fish on each lure, and then we'd try something else just to see what would work for tomorrow for the Derby. So we got a pretty good idea what's working and where to catch them.
Welcome back to the Kokanee Power of Oregon's Green Peter Reservoir Kokanee Derby. Oh, yeah. I'm Justin Wolf.
Right,
the campground's so a busy place the evening before the Derby, woo-hoo, as tackle and techniques are discussed. Kokanee anglers tend to be very conscious of scents, even more so than bass anglers, so showing up with a big box of Procure will really make you some friends in a hurry. But early the next morning, it's all about catching kokanee. Located in central Oregon, not far from Lebanon, Green Peter Reservoir is a beautiful place to spend a day kokanee fishing. And while it's a good-sized lake, many fishing the Derby seem to be concentrated in one area. That's certainly holding fish. Now it's just a matter of finding the right combination of tackle, scent, and technique.
We're starting out this morning using a Crip lure, and I've dyed this corn up with the Wizard Red Kokanee Magic. And what it does is it firms the corn up, it adds a bite stimulant to it, and it makes it so it won't get slime up on you. This corn will go for about a week to 2 weeks in your refrigerator without getting all slimy.
Right away, it's obvious that Gary Morales and his partners for the Derby, Wayne Duma and Larry Ellis, have it figured out.
That fish came on the... Got another fish behind us.
Let me get the net.
Well, we got another one on there. That last fish came
on
a super glow sling blade with a glow coconut, glow pink. And then we're picking them up on glow cripplers as well. The redhead's been doing pretty good. Been running everything glow this morning, of course. It's pretty dark conditions. Glow will always do a pretty good job first hours in the morning. A little corn, running garlic Procure for their corn.
We hit it. We've got three fish in the boat right now, and we're looking for some bigger fish. We found a little school out in this area of the lake, but sometimes the bigger fish are by themselves, so that's what we're kind of moving around looking for. The fish are about 40 feet deep right now, and as the day goes on, they'll get a little deeper as the sunlight hits the water. But it's still early. We've only been fishing a half hour or so hopefully we'll find some bigger ones. Yesterday we pre-fished it, and we caught some really nice fish on up the lake a little ways, and we'll hit up there in a little bit. But right now we're getting fish here, so we don't want to go too far away from where we're catching fish at.
That's not a very big fish. I mean, there's actually much bigger fish in here, but that's probably close to the average size in this lake. And nice thing about these fish, so they're not bad size for early in the year. They'll grow a good inch a month, so we've got a few more months of growth here before these fish will actually quit growing. So, yeah, we could see some 17 and a half inches come out of here this year with some of the bigger fish that we caught yesterday. Another thing we like to use is a dropper. Now basically what a dropper is a lure on about a 2 foot leader that we actually hook on the line that's going down to your downrigger. Now in other words, we're at 40 feet. The water forces your line back and creates a bow. Now when we hook this on that rod and drop it in the water, it'll actually go down and seek the middle of that bow, and it'll just sit there and swim back and till the fish hits it. Then you gotta release it, and then you gotta kind of speed reel at that point, because this lure is going to free fall. If you're back 50 feet, it's going to fall at 20 feet, an additional 50. So you got 70 feet before you're actually going to feel that fish. You'll actually hit that next snap that's with the other lure, and then boom, there you are. But the neat thing about this, it allows you to cover more depths. When we're only able to use one rod, this will allow you to fish two lures at one time, and it does make a big difference. What you want to do is just kind of snap that on there. You got the lure back, and then what we'll do, you got to be careful not to snag the line on the way out. Now I take the lure and just kind of throw it out to the side.
Fish on.
And we've got a fish on right here.
You're reeling
good
in.
Job.
You got that fish? No, he hit it a little earlier. I was kind of messing with the rod there.
All right. Now we picked up another one here.
Oh, he's a good one.
Oh, good. That's always a good thing.
He's fighting pretty good.
All right.
He couldn't get off. Ooh, he's fighting good.
All righty. Maybe we got that 16-incher we were looking for.
Would be nice.
It's a decent fish. We need to pull that other rod out of the way, or we
no,
good?
No, it's all right. All right. I'll get him back.
Yeah, that's there. There we go. Good. Yeah, he felt good. That's a decent
nice
fish. Good. Yeah, he probably felt a little bigger than he was because the hook was in his chin. That always helps. Okay, look at that.
Yeah.
There you go. You know, when apex is a popular lure for kokanee fishing. Now, I notice a lot of the guys. I notice a lot of the guys fishing apex are running sling blades with them. Is that because of the speed variances and that?
I think they just work good together because the sling blade slings it around so much, plus the apex wiggles so much, and together it's just real erratic and the fish like it.
Yeah, plus I think that speed-wise, because a sling blade, you can run them up to 2 miles an hour. Some guys like to run apexes up to that upper end, and I know most conventional dodgers will start rolling on you at those fast
speeds. Yeah, and the sling blade won't. It just really moves around, gives a lot of action to the lure.
That's good. It's been working today pretty well.
Yeah.
I notice we're starting to get a little bit of rain or a little mist in the air. So much for that early morning sunshine we were hoping for.
Oregon mist.
Let's get our speed back up a little bit.
We're trolling at about 1.2 to 1.5 miles an hour. Kind of depends on the lures we're using, but we're using a lot of hoochies and spinners and the crip lures, and they seem to like around that speed. So we're kind of varying it to see what they like this morning, but most of it's been between 1.2 and 1.5.
And we got a glow hoochie, glow blade. We'll run this glow for the first hour or so this morning, and then once things start brightening up, we'll go back to the UVs that we were using yesterday in a lot of brighter colors, but this definitely will make a difference early morning. Generally at the depth we're fishing, we like to get back probably 50 feet or so. You know, if you're shallower than that, you're working the 20-foot water, so you want to get back probably 100 feet, but 50 feet is sufficient when we're down around 40.
Oh yeah, he's on. Oh, yeah. Nice one.
Boy, he made a turn.
Yeah, I know, I saw that.
He all of a sudden went sideways.
Good tracking there, Gary. Good job.
There you go.
All right.
Whoa. Oh, me bumping it. Bump the rod with the
beautiful kokanee.
Yeah.
Gorgeous nice fish. Here.
Now, one of the things you've got to do when you're kokanee fishing is adjust the leader length for the type of lure that you're using. Now, generally speaking, a lure like this coconut, which doesn't have any action to itself, you're going to fish those fairly close to the dodger. You can see we've got that about 1.5 times the length of the dodger. That's generally what we're going to run on that type of a bait. Same thing on your when you're fishing the hoochies, like this ultraviolet peewee. You want to run those short. There again, there's no action to them. When we're fishing like a lure like the glow redhead crippler here, which has been doing well, we're going to fish that in tandem, and generally I run those about the length of the two dodgers. And sometimes we'll go a little further than that, but that's generally a pretty good layout right there. Also, lures like the peewee wiggle hoochie, there again, this is a real hyper-action lure. You can run that back as far as 18 inches and find good success with it. So just remember, the key there is, if it has no action, run them close. If you've got action, then you can go back, you know, quite a bit further. But I think you'll find good success if you kind of follow that rule. And one more thing, I like to run the fluorocarbon leaders, and P-Line makes the best fluorocarbon out there, and we're running 8-pound right here today.
Welcome back to Green Peter Reservoir. I'm Justin Wolf. Today's Kokanee Power of Oregon's Green Peter Reservoir Derby is producing plenty of fish, but a weak cold front has moved in, changing the conditions enough to make the fishing a little challenging for many anglers. Gary Morales and his partners are catching plenty of quality fish, a sign that they've figured out the right combination of lures, scent, and technique, the basic problem that everyone's trying to solve.
We started out this morning fishing for the kokanee, and we are using the wizard-cured pink corn. But as the morning goes on, I'm gonna try some different colors. And I've got three here that I'm gonna try. I've got a hot pink, orange did real well yesterday, and then I'm gonna do some corn up in the purple. And these have all been cured with the Wizard Natural Kokanee. All you have to do is just put a couple of drops in here. And I just do a little bit of the corn at a time till I find out which color they're working on. I have a feeling today it's going to be the orange because that's what was hot yesterday. And once you put the dye on these, it'll be fully absorbed and into the corn in a matter of about 2 minutes where you can use it. All we're going to do is just stir it around, then we'll drain off the excess juice. Normally I'd put them in a strainer and let them drip out of there, but I don't have a strainer on the boat today, so we're just going to do it the old-fashioned way. The cool thing with this dye is it's got the UV brightener in it. So even a day like today, we don't have a lot of sunshine, but you know, we've got the clouds, but these will still light up under the water. In the old days, when you fish for the kokanees, it was important to use a rubber snubber because the kokanee have such soft mouths. But Rogue Rods has this rod out that we're using today that's a composite graphite and a glass rod. So it's got a super sensitive tip. When the kokanee hits this, it pretty much takes it right down in the water. So it's eliminated the need for me to use a snubber.
Oh, we've caught two so far. Two little ones. Yeah, we're just running Shasta sling blades and some pink hoochies right now. We ran some apex, caught one on an apex this morning, and lost one on a spinner. We're fishing down about 30 feet right off of a drop-off off here on the, I guess it'd be the east end of the lake here. What we're trying to do in this area here is there's a shallow ledge that comes off and drops back out into about 70 feet of water. And there's some pretty good schools of fish right laying off that ledge there. And basically we're just running around making circles around that ledge and trying to keep off the bottom. This is just one of the derbies Kokanee Power of Oregon puts on. We hope to see some of you folks out at some of our future derbies. Diamond Lake's coming up and Odell Lake. Hope to see you out there.
Well, we've had a pretty tough morning this morning. We've found a lot of fish, but we haven't caught a lot of fish. So we had a little place up here that we did pretty good yesterday afternoon. We're going to go up and give it a shot and see what we can do this morning. Well, we've run back up here on this little, I think some little drainage. I'm not real sure. It's probably the sand yam, I think. When we fished Green Peter Reservoir last week, or a week before last month, I guess it really was, the fish were laying back in this cool water coming in. So we're just going to give this a try. We're going to run back up in here. We did pretty good up towards the mouth of this yesterday, so we just ran a little deeper back in here. We're going to run little Uncle Larry's lure here in a sling blade from Jasta Tackle. And then a little home cured corn on it, and we're just going to troll out of here at about 20-25 feet until we get into the deeper water. You can see I personally like a really long rod for fishing kokanee. This is one of Rogue's steelhead rods. It's SH-1063, 10 foot 6 long, and I think you lose less fish with a long rod, a long light rod on these kokanee. They're real soft mouth. So you can play them really gingerly on this nice long rod. It happens to be my favorite G. I use it for a lot of things, but I really, really like it in these downriggers for kokanee. John over here, he's using our kokanee rod. It's a 7'9" and more what you'd use for this type of fishing. Oh, there he is. Uh-oh, looks like a little trout. I'm afraid of that. My partner was right. We'll probably get into the kokanee a little further out as we work our way out of here, but got a nice little trout right now. I'm having a mixed morning. This is my trifecta. I've got kokanee trout. I've got a crappie this morning. We've kind of got it all. Here's my mixed bag. Beautiful crappie. Beautiful kokanee. And then we just released a couple of three trout so far. We kind of got the old Green Peter trifecta. Good job.
Rick and his partner John had a slow morning, but now they're getting into some quality kokanee. Big enough for Rick to find himself tied for first place.
Well, it looks like we got a tie. It's 4.31, so now we've got to measure these two fish, and whoever's got the longest fish is the winner. Who is that?
Do we go by girth and length?
Well, if it's girth, you win.
I win. I got it. And I'm taller.
You are taller.
Everybody's taller.
No, it's actually got to be the fish, guys. All right, so here we go.
When we return, it's a game of millimeters at the Kokanee Power of Oregon's Green Peter Reservoir Derby. It's time for the weigh-in at the Kokanee Power of Oregon's Green Peter Reservoir Derby. But first, we need to get our barbecue and check out all of the great raffle prizes. In this Kokanee Derby, a side pot for Chinook salmon was available as well.
Are you in the pot for Chinooks?
I hope so.
Curtis. What's your name?
Curtis.
That's a good name.
Got an Anderson special lure. It was lime green, and it was on the downrigger, so I popped it off the downrigger and played with it and fluttered it for a little bit, and it hit about 20 feet down.
That's your first fish? Was it fun?
In the junior division, yeah. Dawson Dye blew away the competition.
Oh, there you go. That's a kicker. Gotta have those kickers. 4.12.
But in the end, after all the great stringers were weighed in, we ended up with a tie for first place.
4.31. Not too bad for a rod guy.
Right up top. Wow. All right. Actually, you better hang on to those fish because that's a tie.
Well, it looks like we got a tie. It's 4.31. So now we've got to measure these two fish, and whoever's got the longest fish is the winner. Who is that?
Do we go by girth and length?
Well, if it's girth, you win.
I win. I got it. And I'm taller.
You are taller.
Everybody's taller.
No, it's actually got to be the fish, guys. All right, so here we go. What do we got? To the tip of the tail, to the nose, and I can just barely read that. You got your glasses on.
57.5.
57.5?
Bottom part.
Whose fish was that?
That was
Jack Schultz. Yes.
And
Rick Fielder.
Rick Fielder's.
Fifty-five.
It got shrunk while I was in there. Very
shrunk.
Congratulations, Jack. Good job.
There you go, Jack.
Good job, Jack. He's worth the trip, huh?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, that's a long haul, buddy.
Jack down from California. Drove about, 7, 8 hours to get up here? 10 hours.
10 hours.
Wow.
We appreciate the support, Jack.
No problem. Yes. Thanks.
Thank you.
Excellent. Good job.
I had a sling blade and apexes.
Ah, there you go.
I'll tell you what.
Good job, bud.
All right, thank
you. All right, now,
in the money.
Yeah, it's his first trip up here to the lake. $400. Jack Schultz, you traveled a long ways, but you proved that you definitely know what you're doing. You've been doing this a while. Share with us what you did this weekend.
We fished from the island to the floating outhouse and around the outhouse, 40 feet. Chartreuse with red polka dot apex and orange wiggle hoochie and sling blades and some Uncle Larry spinners. And that was about all we used.
Yeah, just about everything in the tackle box. Right.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.